This presentation of Berks County Outdoors is funded by contributing members of the Federated Sportsmen's Clubs of Berks County.
Hello again, and welcome to Berks County Outdoors. Did you see that notice they put up? BCTV is very worried about what we're going to say.
I'd be worried too.
Well, you know, we're not going to do anything bad. We never do, but they always warn you. These guys can say anything, they'll do anything. But welcome. Happy New Year. Merry Christmas. Hope you had a great holiday. We got a busy show for you today, so let's get going. Thanks for joining us. I'm Roger Mallon.
And I'm Bob Entler. Welcome to Berks County Outdoors here on BCTV, fourth Monday of the month, 8 o'clock. We are live. At this point, we can't take calls. We're not set up for that. But we hope you're watching us maybe on TV right now, Channel 15, Berks Cable, also live stream, BCTV.org. Try that. Once a month we're here.
Yeah.
And we're going to be talking about some fishing, hunting, and things have gone on in the past year.
Yeah.
Roger?
Some highlights from 2021. You want to start out?
You give me a highlight there.
I'll give you a highlight.
Give me a highlight there.
BCTV's new studios. There's a highlight for
That's
you.
Right.
Brand new studios in downtown
right.
Reading, 4th and Penn.
That's right.
And a beautiful new studio. So there's a highlight. I got another one for you.
I got another one.
In the world of fishing here in Pennsylvania, the opening day of trout next spring is going to be a one-day-only statewide trout opener. You probably know that already, but I'd certainly put that down as a highlight. It's going to be the first Saturday of April, always from now on, unless they change it. But it's going to be the first Saturday of April from now on, statewide. Opening day of trout, and that means everything else kind of gets pushed back a little bit, like the Mentored Youth Day. That'll be the last Saturday in March, the week before the opener. And then, of course, trout stocking will probably start in mid-February now. We're going to find out about that. You want
that,
another one? Or
that
you
date,
got,
well, the,
the dates?
The date will be Saturday, April 2nd.
Yep.
The day
and
after.
March 26th.
That's right, the day after April Fool's Day. So
yes.
No fooling. That's right, I got the new calendar from the Pennsylvania Game Commission. Update it, and you can go out to the Game Commission office out on Snyder Road, and you can get your own, and it has some great pictures in here. I think in the past they did animals and birds, but it seems that
separate
maybe
calendars.
They have combined them.
Yeah.
So each picture on the page there, well, there you can see it looks like an elk, a squirrel. That's the only one that doesn't have the bird, but all of the rest of them do have. There's a nice picture there, nice blue bird and a rabbit and it looks like a heron of some kind there. That looks like a night heron or a green heron, I believe that's what that is. Anyway, you can pick them up. I think they're just around $10. And they got a lot of good dates on there from the Game Commission when seasons are open and just different things. It's showing the Howard Nursery Seedling Sale and where you can get them. That's coming up on the 20th of January this month.
Hey, maybe some of you folks went out hunting today.
That's
Archery
right.
And muzzleloader started again, the winter season. So we'd like to hear if you had any success that way.
Speaking of flintlock muzzleloader season that opened up. We're going to be talking a little bit about my gun and just show you how, just see how it operates and, put a little powder in there, a little in the flash in the pan and make a little spark and make a little smoke.
Yeah.
Just a little smoke.
I got another highlight for you.
Highlight.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
The current president for this 2022 for the Pennsylvania Fish and Boat Commission lives in Leesport, Pennsylvania, and his name is Rick Kaufman. Congratulations to Rick. He's now the president of Pennsylvania Fish and Boat Commission. I'd say that was a highlight.
And the commissioners helped to guide the Fish Commission with rules and regulations and directions in which way the things should go.
Yeah.
From a lot from public input. Yeah, we talk to Rick a lot.
Yeah, Rick is out everywhere right now, all over the state, getting acquainted with folks and listening. Listening is the important part. I'd give you another one, digital licenses for fish and boat and for hunting. digital licenses. You can put them on your phone, you can carry them in your wallet, but you don't have to have them pinned on your hat or pinned on your back. Not any longer. Although some folks are still doing it. They still want to do it. Multiple copies are a good idea if you're going to print your license off. Bob always likes to remind folks of that.
That's right.
I
printed out several copies.
For himself and for his friends.
My friends, yeah, sure. Yeah.
See, that's sure. Why they put that warning up at the beginning of
yeah,
the show.
That's right. Make sure that you have your ID with you. In other words, you need your driver's license, some kind of picture ID to go along with that license that you have maybe in your pocket or your wallet or what have you.
Yeah.
And I print out multiple copies, so I put one in my boat, one in my tackle box, one in my desk in case I do lose it. You know, so they're there. Yeah. Very easy to do that. I got the trout stamp. That's imprinted, a logo imprinted right on the license itself. They're available right now. Go online at the Pennsylvania, either the Game Commission or the Fish and Boat Commission. You can get it either place online. Very easy to do.
Yeah. The fish and boat license runs from January through December. But, of course, the hunting license runs from July through the end of June. So it goes with the seasons in that case. The elk cam, the eagle cam, all both huge successes. Had a chance to go on the Game Commission website and watch live activity out there in Benazet for the elk and all around the state for eagles. We got good news also that coming in 2022, the NRA's Great American Outdoor Show. Great American Outdoor Show is coming back to Harrisburg after a hiatus due to COVID.
Yes, it is. February 5th through the 13th. So mark that down on your calendars. February 5th through the 13th out at Harrisburg. Yeah. The Harrisburg Show.
Harrisburg Show is back.
That's right.
Yeah. Also, I was going to say there's another show that we want to tell you about in Kempton this year. It's the Kempton Gunmakers Fair. Now, many of you remember the Dixon Gunmakers Fair that specialized in muzzleloaders, just like Bob's going to show you in a minute. But it's now, the Dixons aren't running it anymore, and they're going to have a new group of people managing it, and they're calling it the Kempton Gunmakers Fair, July 29, 30, and 31st, up at the Kempton Community Center. So keep that in mind as well. That's a big show. It draws about 8,000 people.
We want to get a special thanks out to Tim Mazeka. Tim Mazeka started and was running Friends of Kershaw Creek. It was a Facebook page, and he had two cleanups. They went around in the park. They had one in the spring and one in the fall where they just went around the park and did some grass cuttings, picked up branches that had fallen down, picked up trash. But unfortunately, I think Tim might be easing up on that. It's very difficult. It's difficult to get volunteers. It's difficult to get the cooperation of there is no cooperation at all from the county, which formerly was a county park. It is no longer. They've kind of abandoned it because of the possibility of finding the battery casings. Well, they did find the battery cases, but also with the Fish Commission. They've tried many, many times to get full cooperation, and it's just been tough, and Tim's just maybe had it up to about there right now.
You know, another highlight for the year, the bass tournaments on Tuesday night at Berks at Blue Marsh Lake.
At Blue Marsh Lake.
It's run by the Berks Bassmasters.
That's right. We had great cooperation, great participation in the tournaments. Just about every Tuesday night, once they opened about in the middle of June, they went to about the middle of September every Tuesday night. Our club, Berks Bassmasters, ran that. We had a minimum of 40 boats just about every week, and sometimes even 50 plus boats, so very popular, and congratulations to the guys that won money. That was paying out maybe $700 for first place,
Roger.
It was a
good tournament. Very good tournaments.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, excellent tournaments.
Yes, it was.
One bit of sad news, which could be considered a highlight, I guess. In the world of hunting here in Pennsylvania, we established a sixth disease management area to try to control chronic wasting disease. I almost said COVID, but chronic wasting disease. This one is right up around Benazet and Elk County. It is encroaching. Chronic wasting disease is now encroaching upon the elk herd in Pennsylvania, which is very, very scary. But that was established this year and enlarged again in the same year. Disease management area number 6. And those of you who hunt those disease management areas certainly know the rules that must be followed in order to try to curtail the expanse.
Another highlight that took place last year and will take place again this year over at Blue Marsh Lake, the Army Corps collected and asked for people, once they were done with their Christmas trees, you know, maybe right about now, and you can do this now, you can go over to the State Hill Boat Launch and take your live or cut, fresh cut, Christmas tree that you're done with, and there'll be an area over there that you can place them, and eventually they will be put in the lake. They'll be put in the lake as they did last spring before the water was brought back up to summer level. So what we ended up doing, we helped a bunch of different clubs helped out also there. We drilled a hole through the trunk of the tree, ran a steel cable through there, then went through a cinder block and then another tree, a cinder block, and we kind of put them in one of the coves right around State Hill. And it worked. It provided the habitat for small fish, and I caught a number of bass and a couple of muskies right around those trees. Right now, with the water drawn down, you can see exactly
where they are. Yeah.
We'll be doing that along with the Army Corps of Engineers again this year. So if once you're done with your tree, when you take your tree down, a real one, not artificial ones, make sure all the ornaments are off and take them over to the State Hill Boat Launch, and there'll be an area there you can stack them. I'm sure they'll end up with a couple of hundred trees.
Yeah, they had a lot left over last year, that too many for the water, so they took them over to State Game Lands and laid them out and created habitat.
Yeah, good way to recycle them, so we're not filling up landfills.
Yeah.
Yes.
One last item, and then we'll turn it over to Bob to talk about muzzleloader hunting, and that is that, where's my notes here?
How about a record walleye, Roger?
Well, we had a new state record walleye. I wasn't going to mention it, but we do have a new state record. It's 18 pounds, 1 ounce, compared to 17 pounds, 9 ounces. That is a big walleye.
I think we also had a state record with the flathead, Roger.
Well, that switches back and forth. I think right now it's like 54 pounds, and it bounces between Schuylkill River and Susquehanna River. Then Schuylkill River gets a big one, and then Susquehanna River. And our friend Vinny Dick Jr., who's going to be on our radio show next Sunday, this coming Sunday, I should say, he thinks there'll be a state record taken out of Blue Marsh, too.
So oh, yeah.
They're
oh,
around. Yeah. They're big, and they're around. And I can't find this note I had here.
Yes.
So well, let's, Bob, why don't you...
Okay, while you're looking for your note there.
I don't know where it is.
I brought along my flintlock muzzleloader rifle. I got this rifle probably, I'll bet it's 20 some years ago already. And this was made by George Deck. And George Deck has since passed away. And this is a 45 caliber flintlock muzzleloader rifle, a long rifle. This is made after the Tennessee style flintlock. Similar also to the Pennsylvania style. I'm not really sure what the big difference is.
Probably hardware.
It could be hardware. There probably still is up at the Bolton Plantation that's just right a little bit north of Nazareth. There's a complex there, and they had a gun shop, and George worked in that gun shop, and Roger and I had gone up there to do a program and an interview and get some information from them, and I asked George at that time, I didn't have a flintlock muzzleloader, and I asked him, do you have any for sale? And there were a number of them on a rack at the gun shop there. And I said, are any of them legal to use to hunt deer? And to make it legal to hunt deer, well, it has to have the flintlock mechanism here. And it also has to have a minimum of a 45 caliber ball. And he just happened to have this one there, and I purchased it from him. I'm very pleased with it. It's a very accurate gun. He used this gun for competition shooting. I've taken two antlerless deer with this rifle in the past, not recently, but certainly. And
is that wood curly maple?
It's definitely a maple. It's got a little flaming in there, maybe tiger maple. It's got that. So the way a flintlock muzzleloader operates, the mechanism here is, you first of all you pull the hammer back, two clicks, and you have underneath here you have two triggers there. You would put some flash powder in the flash pan right there, close the frizzen, pull the back trigger, which is a set trigger, gets a little click right there, and once that's set, then it's ready to shoot. And it actually did spark. And I think what we're gonna do is...
Did you explain about the flint?
The flint is in there, yes.
Yeah, I don't think you mentioned it.
I'm gonna put a little flash powder in there, just a touch, and we'll see if it does flash. There, that's...
Just a touch.
I'll take a little bit of barrel. But once that ignites, there's a little hole right there in the barrel, and of course that powder and ignition will go in there and set off the gunpowder that's in there, and eventually we'll shoot out the.
Okay.
So we're going to close
sprinklers
the.
Where are the sprinklers?
Close the frizzen there. I got my set trigger, pulled and set, and we'll pull it. And there we go. There we
Look
go.
At
a little
that.
Bit of. Little
oh boy.
Now, of course, when you use
right up
quite a
the
bit.
Sensor. All right, well, we'll see.
So anyway, then what happens? Once this is black powder, and black powder, when it fires and goes off, is very dirty. It leaves a lot of residue. So what you have to do with a flintlock muzzleloader like that, and once after you fire it, you can get. There's a number of commercial products on the market, like cleaner, but really it's water and soap and water. Soap and water is what cleans it, and I use either one or both of these. And all you have to do is take a little bit of this stuff here and put it on a little pad. And I was gonna bring some Q-tips along. That works real nice to clean this part out. And you can see in just that little firing, that there's quite a bit of dirt in there. Now, after you would load the gun, which is not loaded, when you do load a gun, load the flintlock, and of course, it's a muzzle loader. That means it goes in the muzzle in the front of the gun. You would first powder, patch, ball, deer will fall. Powder, patch, ball, we learned that quite a few years ago. Powder, okay, so Roger, hang on to that there. And they have all these neat little tools that you can measure out. In other words, when you watch like on TV and you see these old movies or movies that are representing old style shooting guns and how they're picking them up and shooting them and how quickly they shoot them and fast. Well, I guess if your life depended on it and your life depended on it in a fight, or you really depended on it to get a deer or get game, you better get pretty good at it. And I know some guys, they do have competitions up at the Blue Ridge Muzzleloader Club, and they can get those shots off.
Two shots in under a minute.
Two shots in a minute. That's pretty gosh darn fast. Anyway, so what you do is you have your instrument here to measure out, and it's adjustable. I think I have this measured out to maybe 60 grains of black powder. And this is a coarser powder. This is a 3F powder, okay, coarser. So you fill that, open this up and pour some of that stuff in there to the amount, close it up, okay, and then dump that into the muzzle, okay. So now you have the powder. Then you need to take your ball, the ball. This is a 45 caliber. Now to give you an idea, the next size up is a 50 caliber. 50 caliber is just about a half inch diameter ball. So this is a little bit under a half inch. So you take that and you get a patch. And this is just it's kind of like a waxed piece of material. And I'm not gonna do it right here. Let's see if we can get this down. Okay, there we are. We are there. So the patch would go in there. First, we already have the powder in there, and you put the ball right in the center there. Then you use the short stick here. It's got a little curl in there, and you push that to starter, just to start the ball to get it in there. Then once you have it in there, then you take your ramrod, which is right in there, and then you just jam that all the way down and make sure it's all the way in at the bottom. And once you have it loaded like that, you're pretty much good to go. And you pick that up. I like to, these are very heavy. That, I don't know, I think this is probably about 8 or 10 pounds. So I'll try to either, depending on where I'm hunting, prop it at least like that, or find a Y stick, prop it on there, just get in. It's very difficult, say if you're walking in a field and a deer starts running, to, you know, to pick this thing up and actually shoot it.
Freehand is tough.
Freehand is very tough with this, because you just have just the very slightest delay in that shot. So you almost have to lead a deer or the animal that you're going to shoot a little bit in order to be successful at. I've never been able to do that, or I haven't done that. The deer that I've taken with that, I was in a prone position sitting with a Y stick, and I was able to get him with that. Now, the other thing I brought along there, Roger, is a powder horn, okay? Now, I actually don't use this, but this was made by a good friend of ours who has since passed away, Skip Hamacker. Very kind of famous guy that made these horns, and he made these and did all of the shavings and scratching away of the horn itself, and then did all of the scrimshaw. And if you can see that there, that's all hand done scrimshaw. He actually has on this side a hunter, the sun is there, a deer, another, a dog, then over there's a turkey on there. He also has his little mark on here that he made this, and I think he made this in 2005 is when I got it from him. Mm. He's been gone quite a few years now.
Yeah.
Anyway, so I'm very happy. And it says on there, Robert Entler, his horn, made at Berks County, 1772. I'm feeling my age, I'll tell you that.
See, the thing about muzzleloader hunting is, and this special season for muzzleloaders, is the guys dress up in period costumes, and they carry that kind of paraphernalia with them.
Yeah, yeah.
They have a bag that called a Possibles bag, where they put all that stuff in there, and they go through, and it's really quite historical.
One of the other things I brought along with me, Skip's wife, Jeannie Hamacker, made these hats, you know. It's you do not have to wear any kind of orange during this season, but it's probably not a bad idea. So she would make these hats. I guess that's knitted, I guess.
Knitted.
And then, kind of authentic and in style, not necessarily in color. But also then she got a little bone here. Maybe get that close up there. Yeah, a little bone right there that kind of holds that top part of it. That actually comes from...
I think that's like a French trapper's hat or something.
Yeah, that's from a raccoon, that particular bone. Kind of a...
Once again, they had that sign at the beginning of the program. We can't be trusted. Move on.
Anyway, so Jeannie, I know Jeannie is still alive and kicking, and actually I think she lives here in one of the apartments in downtown Reading here. So Jeannie, if by any chance maybe you're watching tonight, yes, I want to thank
you once
again.
You're taking good care of that hat. Mine's a little torn up.
Yes, I've had this hat many years. Anyway, so that's pretty much what the muzzleloader hunting situation is. And you guys that go out there, you know, good luck to you. Be careful. Be safe. Make sure that if you get a deer, if you've already gotten a deer during the rifle seasons or the archery seasons or the late archery season, which opened also today, make sure you report that harvest. Report the harvest. Very important. Very important. The Game Commission needs your input for that. Report
I found my
your
notes
harvest.
As to what.
Oh, we got the
one of the highlights that right. I forgot to mention, and that is the Sunday hunting.
Oh, that's right.
Was back in effect this year. Three Sundays in a row that took in the bears and the deer and the archery.
That's right.
Seasons, and we expect it to happen again next year. And there's a bill going through the Senate, I think, right now. Trying to give the Game Commission permission to set their own rules and maybe have expanded Sunday hunting opportunities. I hope that does come through. But that was certainly a highlight for 2021. Also, if you remember, from May until August this year, the Game Commission was recommending not to feed songbirds. They were dying, especially here in southeast Pennsylvania and down into Maryland. They were dying for an unknown reason, still an unknown reason. And so they recommended not feeding songbirds. And I know that's a very popular activity. Well, it's almost time to go, Robert.
Yeah, I'm feeding the birds right now.
Oh, yeah?
Feeding the birds and the squirrels, you know. Yeah. Whoever shows up there, they're showing up, too. I fill that feeder. I have a feeder that goes this much. And within a couple hours, boom, gone.
Squirrels or birds?
Both. Yeah, the squirrels get up there. And the birds just, you know, go through it and the doves are there.
I didn't realize that squirrels like suet so much. They're eating my suet.
Yeah, they eat just about anything. They'll get it.
Well, listen, please join us on Sunday mornings at 8 o'clock on WEEU Radio here in Reading, on Berks County. That's where we have our program, Great Day Outdoors. It's been going on for over 30 years. It's an hour-long program. We always have great guests. I mentioned before that Vinnie Dick Jr. is going to be on the show this coming Sunday, and he's one of our favorite guests. And the listeners' favorite guests, too. Certain way of telling a story that people really enjoy. So that's Sunday mornings at 8 o'clock on WEEU.
And once again, don't forget about those Christmas trees. When you're taking your Christmas tree down, the real one, you can take it over to Blue Marsh Lake State Hill Boat Launch. And there's a collection area there, and it's going to eventually be used for structure and habitat in the lake. So a good way to get rid of that tree without filling up a landfill. Let's fill up Blue Marsh.
No, it works. And the trees make great habitat out in the brush for the rabbits and other critters. It's a great recycling opportunity here with those Christmas trees.
That's right. They're giving us a signal, Roger, to get out of here.
Yeah.
So
time to go.
Have a great New Year.
Yeah,
it's just a couple
New
of
Year,
days
everybody.
Away. And I know that they're going to have the fireworks up at the pagoda.
Yeah.
They're not having any indoor activities, but they are going to have the fireworks at 12 o'clock on New Year's Eve.
Yeah.
So enjoy that. Be
till
safe.
Till next month, till next year, we'll see you outdoors. Bye-bye.
This presentation of Berks County Outdoors is funded by contributing members of the Federated Sportsmen's Clubs of Berks County.